Welcome to the Nerd Party.
And now it's
springtime for Hitler and Germany.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Missing Frames. This is the podcast where we watch all the movies we should have seen by this point in our lives. I'm your host, Shawn Eastridge. We're hanging out on the Nerd Party Network, a collection of podcasts dedicated to all things entertainment. Check it out at thenerdparty.com. You can follow us on Twitter at @JoinNerdParty. You can like the Facebook page, The Nerd Party, and follow us on Instagram at The Nerd Party. And oh my God, it's been like months. I've been on hiatus. Listen, people, I had a baby. I don't know if you realize. I don't know if you follow my life, if my life is the most important. Is that him? Hello? Are you there? Is it my son or is it just Richie Pepio hanging out with me again?
It's me and I want my milk.
Oh my God. Typical. It's typical. You come on my show, demand milk. That's how this works. I should have expected it. But it's good to be back on the internet. Not that, you know, with social media, it's not like you ever leave. You have a constant digital footprint. But it's been a while since I did a missing frame. I don't think I ever really explained to anyone who listens that that's where I disappeared to having a baby. But it's good to be back. And it's good, Richie, to have you as my first guest back after a couple months.
It's an honor, Shawn Eastridge. Thanks for having me. You know, last time we were here, what movie did we talk about? We talked about...
I don't remember.
Not Vertigo.
We did Mulholland Drive.
Yes.
We bitched about WandaVision, which got everyone very upset. And then we did Mulholland Drive. And I think people loved that.
You know what I got to say, too?
I'm not going to look into that. I'm just going to say people loved it.
Right. Mulholland Drive was everything that WandaVision wishes it was. But look, enough about WandaVision.
This is exciting. This is a movie I have not seen before and that you love. This is one of your favorite movies. Mm-hmm. It's Mel Brooks' The Producers.
Yes.
Is this your favorite Mel Brooks movie?
You know what? It's close. I really love Young Frankenstein. That's kind of the one I started with Spaceballs because I was a huge Star Wars fan, and me and my cousin, when we were kids, and he was not a Star Wars fan, we watched Spaceballs, and he loved it. So I thought that was the sign of like, wow, this is a parody of Star Wars and some other science fiction movies, and even a non-Star Wars fan can get behind this. Why did it take me so long to find Spaceballs? And then from there, you know, Young Frankenstein, which I think is really that. Might be Mel Brooks's best movie. There's just something like it is very much a tribute to those old Universal horror films, but there's like something greater about it. Somehow balances like Mel Brooks's zany stupidity with there's this like wistful, there's like this weird wistful like beauty, sadness. I don't know what it is, some ethereal something in that black and white film. And they use the original set pieces too from the 1930s Frankenstein. So I love that movie. Sorry to digress, but then Producers is like a close second.
It was Producers that this was this his first film or was it like it was his breakthrough film? For some reason I'm thinking both. This was like his first big thing.
Yeah, so he had written for your show of shows, Sid Caesar's show from the early to mid 50s, which had like this insane famous writing staff with like Woody Allen, I think, was a writer's assistant at some point later on down the road. Larry Gelbart wrote for the show. A bunch of other people, Carl Reiner wrote for it as well. And it's just a very funny, hilarious, ahead of its time sketch comedy show. Mel Brooks wrote for that. And he and many of the other writers and staff members on that team ended up like becoming big in the decades that followed. And so this was his first movie. I think he'd written a musical and that inspired him. That was a failure, but it inspired him to write The Producers about failed musicals. And he won an Oscar for it, which I think was a shock to him as well.
Yeah, and it's amazing I've never seen it because I do like Mel Brooks a lot and I've seen almost, I think almost every big movie he's done, Blazing Saddles and Young Frankenstein, and what else is there? What else? I've seen Robin
Silent
Hood,
Movie, Spaceballs. High Anxiety.
I don't know if Spaceballs. I've seen Silent Movie. Maybe you showed me Silent Movie.
I don't think
like
I did, but you know maybe, what? Maybe we could watch that another episode.
Maybe we could watch that instead. Silent Movie, everybody. I you know what's funny about Mel Brooks? I like him a lot, but I don't know if I don't want to say never loved a Mel Brooks movie, but I haven't seen them recently enough to know how much I love them or how much I enjoy them. I remember thinking like they're almost a little bit, this isn't an insult, they're a little bit slower and more thoughtful than I think what I expect from a parody film. Mm-hmm. Like I think of the Zucker Brothers, yeah, and Airplane, and those are like a laugh a minute, like very, very laugh, yeah, out loud. Whereas Mel Brooks, especially like Young Frankenstein and things like that, they're funny, but they're a little bit more like the laughs are more paced and you're actually kind of following a story. Yeah. And I think seeing his films for the first time, that kind of put me off a little bit because I was like, oh, this is funny, but like the laughs aren't coming as quickly, or maybe I'm just not getting it or something like that. But I honestly, like, it's been so long since I saw Blazing Saddles that I might as well have not seen it. It's been a while since I've seen Young Frankenstein. I don't really remember the movies, like, and I remember enjoying them, but for some reason they haven't stuck with me like something like Airplane. And I have a Mel Brooks Blu-ray collection and the Producers is not in it for some reason. I don't know why. This is arguably,
wait, really? Oh yeah, I think because the rights are owned by a smaller art house, like
maybe that's it.
But that's so odd because it is like considered by many to be his masterpiece, or at least, yeah, his first big hit. Like that and Blazing Saddles and Young Frankenstein, I feel like are his trifecta.
They're the essential. So it's weird that essentials. You have like, oh, the Mel Brooks collection and no Producers. So whoever's in charge of that, yeah, get on it. And then send me a replacement set. Like,
yeah, please.
It's the least you could do.
The least you could do. Criterion. Get that. Criterion. Is there a Criterion of any Mel Brooks movie?
I don't think so. But, I mean, come on.
You
come
would
on,
think the Producers would get, if any would get one, the Producers, or at least the 12 Chairs, because, like, so many people haven't seen it, and it's actually.
And 12
very
Chairs
good.
Is in that set. I have that movie, but I
watch
don't have
that
the
next.
Producers. Yeah, I'll watch that after this. So but, like, this is, so I've always wanted to see it. This is a great excuse to see it. But yeah, it's like I've always enjoyed Mel Brooks, but for some reason I've never embraced him. I think like you have, or right, like other people have, because I mean, all his movies are considered
I will
classics.
Say you, yeah, and I'm sorry to cut you off. I was just going to say to your point earlier about like, you know, you were like parody movies. You had different categories for parody movies, and Zucker, Abram Zucker, Zazz, they really nailed it. They knocked it out of the park with Airplane, The Naked Gun, Police Squad, the six episodes of that series, Top Secret. And I grew up like that was, you know, my dad passed that on to me, a heritage, a love of those movies. And to the point where I would like write and illustrate little storybooks continuing the adventures of Frank Drebin, Leslie Nielsen's character from Naked Gun. And to me, actually, I don't know if this is heresy to some fans out there, but I actually do rank those a little higher than Mel Brooks just because they always made me laugh harder. Yeah. I grew up with them a little bit earlier and I was exposed to them a little earlier. And there's a level of authenticity to the source material where, like, not only is Leslie Nielsen just and all the other character actors playing it straight, but they're also, like, you know, they're also actual character actors who appeared in the real movies. The style is so on point. It really is just such an authentic, genuine parody. Whereas Mel Brooks's movies are kind of a hodgepodge. And the chaos is what's so almost beautiful to watch, but they're so essentially Mel Brooks through and through. His personality like bleeds through in like every frame and almost in every performance too. Even though he's not in all of his movies, every actor's performance almost feels like they're interpreting the words of Mel Brooks through the spirit of Mel Brooks is like communicating through them. And that's both a blessing to the movies, but also, like to your point, it makes them a little more niche, maybe.
Yeah, right, that's word. What it's weird that they have such mainstream appeal. And I think part of it is shock value. Like, I think even in whenever Blazing Saddles came out, like 1970, was it three?
I think.
Yeah, when Blazing Saddles came out, I'm sure it was shocking then. If, you know, I'm just waiting for the Blazing Saddles. Do we need to cancel that movie? I'm waiting for that to happen.
Luckily,
but
no.
Like, I think a lot of what Mel Brooks had was like that shock value of like, oh, he's pushing to the edge. And the producers, I know, I mean, I know essentially the plot, which is the two right. guys try to stage the worst musical, and they find this like Hitler, Nazi Germany musical. I know Springtime for Hitler. I know like that song, but I know that's the plot of this. So I think maybe it was just the edginess. But for me, mm-hmm. I think to your point, I think the laughs mm-hmm. are less consistent for me with Mel Brooks than they are in right. something like Airplane or Top Secret. Which I adore, and I think that's what it. Maybe they're it's the laughs are more kind of like chuckles. Like I chuckle more in a Mel Brooks movie, whereas I laugh more when watching a movie like The Naked Gun or Airplane. And so it's I think maybe unfairly comparing the two. And Mel Brooks kind of planted that flag first, I guess, in feature film. I don't necessarily know like the full history of spoof film, but it feels like between Mel Brooks and the Zuckers, like that was kind of the epitome in the 70s and like moving into the 80s of like that genre, like really kind of a peak in a way.
Right.
But that's that tends to be where I side with this. But The Producers is interesting because The Producers is unlike Blazing Saddles and Young Frankenstein and Robin Hood or Spaceballs, which are parodies of something like you can point to the reference. Mm-hmm. Producers is an original, like it's wholly original. Like it's kind of a send up of like musicals, but it's yes. not like parodying something specific, like a specific source material.
Right. It almost parodies like the personalities, the old showbiz types that you would find in older movies about show business. And there is right. a theatrical quality to it, even to the performances. Like I said before, they almost feel like they're, you know, like doing an interpretation of Mel Brooks reading the, like everybody's, the energy is so high and peaked. And there is a very theatrical quality to it, but it works. It lends itself to the sort to the script. I think it supports the words that he wrote.
Well, good. I'm excited to watch it. And like I said, I typically try to predict, or whoever hasn't seen the movie tries to predict the plot. I know generally what the plot is. Again, like the two guys staged the musical, but other than that, I don't know much about it. I expect to be charmed. I expect to be entertained.
Right.
I hope I enjoy it. I hope I'm invested in it maybe a little more than I have been in other Mel Brooks movies. But yeah,
right.
I'm ready to watch it. How about you, Richie?
I'm good. There's a lot of noise happening around me.
Oh, you're good. I can't hear it. But I assume like, that was the excitement of the environment around you chiming in on your behalf.
The world is calling for us to watch this movie.
I can't wait. The world's ready. I'm ready. You're ready. Let's watch The Producers and we'll be back to talk about it.
Let's do it.
Now available to own on video cassette.
And we're back. Richie, I really enjoyed The Producers.
Yay.
I thought it was funny. I thought it was nuts. I still think it falls into the same category of a lot of Mel Brooks movies, like what we were mm-hmm. talking about, where I'm like, I really like this, but it's not hitting my funny bone as much as I would want mm-hmm. a raucous, beloved comedy to do. But I still like had a great time with it.
Great.
Did you have a great time rewatching it? How do
I
you
did.
Feel
I,
about it?
I still... love, like every I was very obsessed with this movie in high school. It was something like I was aware.
There were lines that were yes. in the movie that I'd forgotten that you used to quote, like the "Don't be stupid, be a smarty, come and join the Nazi party," like things like that. Where I was like, "Oh my god, that's right."
Yeah, and LSD, who's not in the musical, the character LSD is probably,
he's so great.
Probably my favorite, one of my favorite performances so of all great. Time, and one of his he has I so many lines from his audition, like. If we had a flower for every gun, there'd be no more wars. Just one big smell in. and he's like singing it too. Or he doesn't remember. He's like, He doesn't remember his name. Oh man, my name, man. Stressed out. That is.
I also love the reaction. So, I mean, this is obviously at the end of the movie, so maybe we'll just get to that later. But I do want to say, just while we're on the topic of LSD, I love everyone is horrified by the play. And then when he arrives on stage, everyone's like, wait. Oh. And then the woman who goes, oh, Harry, he's funny. And they run back in.
They run back in. Yeah.
They're like, oh, it's okay now.
He's so good.
And Harry, he's funny.
Well, I didn't really, I forgot, like, and I didn't realize, I think subconsciously, like, Dick Shawn, who plays LSD, must have influenced me as an actor, because I must, like, in when I was studying theater in college, I was in a lot of like student directed plays, and like that was my comedy spirit animal, was just to be instinctive and like insane, and and I think I must
not
have internalized that in high school. Yeah, no, definitely. Yeah, I mean, the lines that work are great, actually. And I will say this too, there were some scenes when I was younger that didn't work as well for me that now I have more respect for. Like, I kind of found earlier scenes in the movie, especially where, like, Gene Wilder is having a freak out, to be a little excessive and a bit much.
Yeah,
I
felt that a little bit.
But I like it. Like, I just kind of thought, like, I'm hysterical! And I'm, you know, it went on a little too long. Yeah. It was a little annoying. I have more patience for it now. I appreciate that section more. But like, when this movie is funny, it's really funny. And when it's and when it's not as funny, the performances really carry the weight. Like,
are great.
In terms, like, just the lines that really stick out to me too. Of like, anything Zero Mostel shouts is funny because he's shouting it. Like, I'm wearing a cardboard belt! And then he rips it up. There's something about that delivery that kills me. And I was going to make this point. I could make it now or I can make it later. Let's just make it now and we'll come back to it if we want to.
Yeah.
There's something about comedy that's ironically funny. This is a little bit more situational than Seinfeld, I would say, but there's like a clear line you can draw from this movie to the evolution of mainstream comedy in the form of Seinfeld, where it's like very ironic, often dry lines, but that are delivered to the extreme. Like in Seinfeld too, where they're like lines that aren't necessarily laugh out loud funny, but they're delivered at such a high intensity that it becomes hilarious, especially like with like George Costanza or whenever any other character is like put in an intense situation. And you can see also like the Seinfeld characters, they're notoriously also often in like critical analyses of the show, like referred to as like horrible people, and I don't think they really are. I think they point out the things that we all kind of internally think, and they bring a voice to oh, that actually is an annoying tick or an annoying kind of like social rule that we kind of just subconsciously accept, but now they've shed a light on it and it's annoying. And I feel like in this, by the same token, these producers' characters are like presented to, they do horrible things, but they're horrible people, but for some reason, and they way worse than anything that like a Seinfeld character would do in most situations. There are some exceptions, but like you love them because you are rooting in this world. You are rooting for them in this situation. You are rooting for these characters.
Yeah. You're kind of forced to root for them. Like, I mean, you, by necessity, it's like, well, these are the characters I'm hanging out with, but also through performance and sheer likability of these incredibly unlikable people, you're just naturally like, all right, well, okay, let's do it. let's put on the worst play. Let's make a bundle.
And I will say too, to your point, I think Young Frankenstein might be a bit more of an accessible movie. I know Blazing Saddles is a big hit. I really love it, but it's not one of my favorites just because I didn't grow up with it. And I feel like Young Frankenstein is a little sharper. And I feel like this movie, The Producers, is a bit more like traditionally, like in terms of like, if you were to compare like a well-made play, there's just something about this that seems a little bit more, I don't want to say mainstream, but just a little bit more a little tighter, a little bit more together story-wise. But yeah, like for me, this is top tier Mel Brooks, one of the best comedies of all time. Not as, obviously not as, I don't think as funny as like, say, The Naked Gun or Airplane.
Things like that.
I hope that's not heresy. Sorry.
But, I still feel in general that I'm kind of surprised not, I don't know. It is like, you know, when you said that this, it won best screenplay at the Oscars, which is kind of, that's surprising to me. Not that it's a bad script, but it is like, it feels, the movie feels a little meandering, and Mel Brooks movies feel a little meandering to me. I think, like you said, sometimes the jokes, like they hammer past the point of being funny to the point of like, is this that fun? Like the joke will get a nice little like from me, and then it'll keep going, and I'm kind of like, okay, but you got my little chuckle. This isn't funny enough to make me continue to enjoy it.
The passage of time has an effect as well too. I'm sure it would have been funnier watching it in the late 60s.
Well, that's the other thing. I think there are comedies like The Big Lebowski, which I reference constantly as like the comedy that I didn't like and now think is one of the funniest, if not the funniest movie I've ever seen, where Mel Brooks does, I think something like Naked Gun or Airplane is you are getting immediate rewards without having to do as much work. So I'm saying I'm a lazy viewer. So I, when I watch a comedy, I want to be, I don't want to be like forced to find the laughs. I want to be made to laugh. And I think with Mel Brooks, it's a little bit more like you have to find the laughs. You have to find it. Like I was looking through the quotes on IMDb and finding quotes that I like went by so quickly that I didn't even like pay attention to them. Like I didn't even know they were like, for instance, when Max says you have exactly 10 seconds to change that look of disgusting pity into one of enormous respect. I don't even remember that line, and that I reading it on the page is very, very funny. And
I'm having a rhetorical conversation.
Yes. Things like that, where it's just like you, in general, I think because the jokes are a little bit more subtle and it's not, it's funny. I mean, Mel Brooks movies are wacky. Like this is a film that ends with the stage play Springtime for Hitler. And it's about as the payoff is about as amazing and absurd as you would hope it would be. But in general, I think the pacing is so kind of low key and it's, they sit with scenes and they sit with characters and things like that, that I think I start to not lose interest, but I think it's surprising to me that people have embraced them so like, yes, these are amazing and I love watching them, because it doesn't feel necessarily like...
A lot of times they're just
like
remembering the really big moments. And this movie really does have... Moments, yeah. The big moments in this movie are probably...
Great.
I mean, like on par with the biggest moments in any Mel Brooks movie. I'm trying to think of like other big... Like Putting on the Ritz... in Young Frankenstein, and the dance number in Blazing Saddles. Really, I mean, there's a lot of classic moments in Blazing Saddles. I feel like this doesn't have as many, like it doesn't have as wide a variety of, say, classic moments. But Springtime for Hitler is so funny, and the build up to it is so, it's so pronounced, and it takes a really long time to get to. And the little moments in between that punctuate it, like some particular moments with like Zero Mostel courting the old ladies with the auditions. That's our Hitler.
Which, well, I that was really interesting to me, is that I think the opening scene is very much a stage play. Like I was watching it. It takes place in one room.
Yeah.
It's continuous real time. Like it's 22 minutes of real time. It's a scene that goes for that long. And a bunch of things happen in it. But the opening credits, I think the legend is that Superman the movie has the longest opening credit sequence. I don't know. The producers might give that a run for its money, because him kind of courting the old women and the opening credits seems to go on for a while, even though it's very funny. But that to me, I think is why I struggle sometimes with Mel Brooks, is because to me, the joke was funny and then it goes on and on and on. And I'm like, I got it the first time and now I'm losing interest, and then it kind of wins me back over, like because it's still going.
Well, there are jokes that really don't work in some of his other movies too, but you could, the characters are so committed to them And you don't even really necessarily understand, like, you kind of have to put some work into thinking, like, why was this a joke that they put in? And I think it's just that, like, Mel Brooks is such a larger than life personality. I got to imagine having worked with him on these movies was so fun. And the bonding between at least some of the actors that he brings back for other films, you know, with Gene Wilder and with his other movies, Madeline Kahn. But I'm sure they developed a lot of inside jokes along the way that made its way into the movie. That's less funny for us, but because the actors are so committed that it's like, okay, I get it. I think
if you are willing to put in the time, you can find that stuff. Like, you find the things and you find, I think Mel Brooks is that kind of filmmaker where it's like, you have to invest the time. And to be fair, because I haven't necessarily loved any of his movies, I haven't like watched them repeatedly enough to know like, oh, this is funny because this subtle little look between that character and that character was set up in an earlier scene and now it's paid off and it's funnier because I know that because I've seen it a few times. So that's another thing where it's like, there are things about the producers that I'm probably completely missing that went over my head and I just don't get. But sometimes I wonder sometimes if it is the characters, if they're such caricatures, because Gene Wilder's in general, like, what's his name? Zero's character is pretty like, okay, well, he's like sleazy producer, like a con man and da da da. And then Gene Wilder's character comes in and it was harder to get a read. Like you said, the earlier scenes with him where he's just like, kind of like, I'm hysterical and you're jumping on me. Like, what was it? Papaya jumped on Nero.
Like, Nero jumped on Papaya. Papaya. Squash her like a bug.
Yes, which is very funny, but also like it was difficult to get a read on Gene Wilder, and I've seen Gene Wilder in a few things, and I think he's fantastic. But was this one of his first big things as well?
He had done Bonnie and Clyde, and I think this was like his second big movie.
Okay,
and they talk about how like you know the part was originally offered to Peter Sellers. Peter Sellers was like, "Yes, I'll take it," and then never. Mel Brooks never heard from him again until I think the producers was had gotten mixed reviews. A lot of people thought it was in bad taste, and Peter Sellers took out a full page ad in Variety telling people to go see the producers, like, it's brilliant. And that's what I think helped raise it into the movie into like a more public.
Well, that's cool of him to do that after, you know, disappearing.
But I think also like so Gene Wilder was in a movie on Broadway with Anne Bancroft, who Mel Brooks's future wife, who he was dating at the time, and it was like Mother Courage. So this very dramatic Broadway show that apparently Gene Wilder was getting a lot of laughs I was complaining to Mel Brooks after the show. I was like, hey, I don't know why they're laughing. And Mel Brooks was like, you're naturally funny. You know, it's a God. God wants you to be funny, whether you know it or want it or not. And so he, I guess after not hearing from Mel Brooks for a couple years, Mel Brooks showed up at one of Gene's in the dressing room when Gene was performing in a show 3 years later and was like, hey, I finished the script. Here's the producer. We're going. Let's do it.
And he was like, all right, sure. Yeah. Well, there is a feeling of Wilder almost a little lost, which works for the character. Mm-hmm. I mean, that character in general is like completely out of his element and nervous and anxious about everything. And I think maybe Wilder, probably due to his inexperience in front of the camera and maybe even in comedy, because if Bonnie and Clyde was the only other thing he did, like that feels like he was able to put it in the performance, because there is a sense of like some of his jokes don't land the way
you think
I thought they might, but he's so committed to it. Like you said, the commitment is everything for these actors. And when they commit to it, you find it fun. Like him being like, I'm smart. Like and when they're in the boat together, what do you say? I'm smiling or whatever.
Yeah.
He's like, I'm happy.
Yeah.
I'm happy. And they're splashing each other. And it's like, it was just like
a balloon. He's got ice cream at 1.2.
Yes. Which is very funny. And I loved them in front of the fountain where he's like, I'll do it. Yes. And the fountain.
I did that. I actually, wonderful. I think you might have been with us. It was like me, you, and Dewey were in New York, and I danced on the fountain. Like I felt in Lincoln Center, I felt like I had to. But there were people gathered around it. But apparently, you weren't supposed to run around the fountain. I thought because it was in the movie, you run around the fountain. But a police officer blew his whistle at me and yelled at me, so I jumped off.
Oh man!
Hashtag defund the police.
If only I'd known, I could have told that police officer, "Hey, you." It's the producers.
It's, don't you understand? I'm mimicking the ending of this movie that's almost 50 years old. Now over 50 years old. Then almost.
Yeah, it's almost, it, what is it, 52? Now?
Yeah.
52. No, 55.
55, 68.
Can I do math? I don't know if I can do math.
68.
No, six. You're right.
58.
Yeah, you can do math. 53. I can't. 53. Wait, 68 is, you know what?
This, 53.
No, no more math. No more math. There, we have a math quota on Missing Frames.
I was
we've
told that math
way
was
too
not
much time
to be part
to
of this podcast.
So I, yeah, so I, in general, the things that I liked about it were the two of them, obviously.
The great pairing is the heart of the movie.
The pairing is the heart of it, and it makes it work, because I don't know that I like, and this I think applies to a lot of Mel Brooks movies for me, is I didn't necessarily like the characters, but I liked the actors' portrayals of the characters, which I don't know if that's a criticism that makes sense. Like, I feel like
I've made that criticism about other things before, and I don't feel that way about this movie, but I get it, and I think it's fine. Because I think in an argument that I may have brought up at the beginning in the first part of this podcast, that like in a lot of his movies, you get the essence of the actor through the characters. And luckily he casts very lovable, likable people in his movies.
Yeah. Yes.
And very funny people. And Harvey Korman is hilarious in Blazing Saddles and in High Anxiety and in everything he does. It's like so many great actors who keep coming back for more. It's unfortunate Zero Mostel wasn't in another Mel Brooks movie, but actually,
yeah. And I don't think I've seen him in anything, honestly. I don't know if I'm,
he was a stage actor. He was in the original Broadway production of Fiddler on the Roof. I think he's in the movie of Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum. I haven't really seen him in many other things either, but he's,
yeah.
Apparently he was the only choice for this part.
Wow. And he's great.
Yeah. He was a big New York actor, so I'm sure Mel Brooks knew him from the 50s and 60s. And I was just going to say Dom DeLuise in The 12 Chairs, which was Mel Brooks' second movie. Not as popular as this. Pretty like obscure, considering Mel Brooks doesn't have a ton of movies and every other one of his movies seems to have like a following, but it is very funny. And Dom DeLuise basically plays the Zero Mostel part in that movie. He's just a loud and obnoxious, scheming Russian priest trying to steal these hidden like family jewels that a bunch of people are chasing after. And Dom DeLuise is so ludicrous and insane. And like every other character is way more understated compared to him. Like it's set in Russia. It's like, it's obviously you could tell like Mel Brooks has this love for Russian novels, the classic Russian novels. You feel it in this movie. And very much like Woody Allen's Love and Death, like Mel Brooks's version of that. But like Dom DeLuise is so out of place and probably gives one of my favorite comedic performances of all time in a movie that's like a bit forgettable without him.
Right.
It's worth, just watch it for Dom DeLuise giving a Zero Mostel like performance in that movie.
Someone else I really love in the movie is Kenneth Mars.
Yes.
Who is great. Yes. Who that character, what is it? Franz
Liebkind. Yes.
Who wrote Springtime for Hitler and wrote it as a sincere love letter and is horrified when they turn it into like a zany musical comedy, and then all three of them are horrified together when it becomes like a smash hit,
a smash comedy.
But I think he's a great example of what Mel Brooks excels at, is casting people who can commit to these characters who aren't necessarily saying funny things, but because they're so committed to their roles, the things become funnier with him. I must tell the birds and things like that. Like
apparently he was like haggling with Mel Brooks over how much pigeon shit should be on his German helmet. Like he went full method.
That's a real actor.
Creeped everybody out.
Was he in Malcolm in the Middle?
Yes. Yeah. And Cloris Leachman was in Malcolm in the Middle too. I think they were cast because of their Mel Brooks connection. I think
that's great. I was like, is this the guy who is the
100%
the older brother? Owns the ranch that the older brother works at. So it is him. Okay, that's great. So that on top of everything is, it makes me happy. And I also loved the secretary. What does he say? Do work and she dances.
Ula,
yeah.
Good day.
Which again is one of those jokes that like maybe overstays its welcome, but also like is funny. So I don't know.
I was so proud of like my movement teacher in college was like, you know, we were slow. Everybody was like easing into class before the start of movement class, or it was like voice and speech, but there was like movement involved. And she started, I guess, doing a very vague like dance to herself, humming that the song that Ula dances to. And I was like, the producers? And she was like, oh my God. It was a big moment that nobody cares about except for me.
You're hired
15 years ago.
Yeah. I love that. But I love that you, because you and I met because we were humming Superman, or you were humming Superman and I recognized it. Yes. So I love that music in general. You recognizing songs is a crucial part
of
your life.
We've made that like part of our catalog too, where we've hummed, we'll harmonize, like you'll do the strings, I'll do the bass and the drums. You know, we really are able to capture John Williams' essence.
We know. I think for sure he would be very, very happy.
Yes. I just wanted to say real quick, because we were talking about Franz Liebkind, and I almost want to say Hans Gruber. And we were talking about, apparently, Dustin Hoffman was up for that part.
I don't think I would have liked him as much.
Well,
as I love Dustin Hoffman, but I don't think I would have loved him in that role.
No, I don't think he's anywhere near as good as
it's to speak to Mel Brooks' talent of casting. And at a certain point, Gene Wilder obviously became a well-known name, and partly due to Mel Brooks. But Dustin Hoffman, I feel like, though he's a great actor, the star power of him would almost make him so self-aware in the role that it would reduce the quality of that,
especially now, knowing what he'd become. Because I guess
in 1967 he was about to do the Graduate.
The reason he's not in this movie was because I guess they dramatize it like it's the night before filming, like a couple days before we were about to film, he got called in to audition, and Mel Brooks was like, he'll go, he won't get it, they're looking for like an attractive young guy. and then he got it.
They were like, we want to cast against type, so they cast Dustin Hoffman.
And he's perfect.
And I'm glad, again, offense to Dustin Hoffman, no offense to The Graduate, one of my favorite movies, but I'm glad he did that and not this, because I think Kenneth Mars is perfect and is essentially playing the same character in Malcolm in the Middle, only less Nazi. I love him in the crowd watching the play, just being generally, like, genuinely horrified at what's happening, and it's great.
It's a great ending. It's funny too, you know, as the first time I watched this, because I was a big Mel Brooks fan of the movies I had seen, but this was a movie that, even like, you know, as a kid growing up, my parents hadn't seen, so I wasn't like weaned on this. But I remember seeing it and the Springtime for Hitler sequence in the like AFI's 100 laughs or whatever, that like their comedy list. It was very high up there. So I was like, oh, this looks very funny. And it's Mel Brooks. I guess I got to watch it. And I became a fan after watching, you know, I was probably 14 or 15 at the time. I guess, where was I going with that other than?
I don't know.
I had a great ending.
It made you happy. And
I had a great finish for that, but I forget where I started. Now I don't know where I'm going.
That's fine. I wonder, like, I'm looking through like what people reacted, how they reacted to this movie at the time. And, in general, it doesn't seem, again, it's shocking that he won Best Screenplay, because it doesn't seem like people necessarily were super into it. Like, they were very like, this is grotesque.
It beat 2001,
it's funny,
A Space
kind
Odyssey,
of, but
for Best Screenplay.
Does 2001, does that even have a screenplay?
I mean, I think like, it was, I am happy that it won, but I just think it's surprising that it
I mean,
beat
yeah,
these
it
other
is, it
movies.
Is surprising, but I would also argue like 2001, what is the screenplay for 2001?
Space.
Like, the monkeys are fighting each other. Space, yeah, a spaceship hovering for 50 minutes. But I, what was I saying? Oh, in general, the
is there a
critical reaction to the movie.
Podcast?
Yeah, we're very, very distracted. But in general, people didn't seem to love it, is what I'm saying. I mean, now
I think
in retrospect,
Wikipedia
people love
and
it,
like
but
IMDb are just showing the bad reviews, though, too.
Yeah, it's I mean, but this is what happens. A lot of times these movies come out and people don't like it, and then in retrospect they will say, oh, this is amazing, we love it. But
Roger Ebert loved
things,
it. Roger Ebert
loved it. Are you gonna tell the elevator story?
You tell it.
You know, Richie, you tell it.
Roger Ebert. So get this, audience. Imagine you're in an elevator, not unlike the elevator in Roger Debris' apartment complex, where you're Roger Ebert, soon to be a famous critic, but at the time you've just wrote Beyond the Valley of the Dolls, the screenplay, and you're trying to make your way in Chicagoland's critical community. You're on an elevator with, I'm going to assume Anne Bancroft is there, and Mel Brooks. An old lady gets on. She looks at Mel Brooks, and she says, I'm not looking at the quote, so I'm just making this up. She looks at Mel Brooks, and she said, ashamed of yourself, Mr. Brooks, and what you've done.
She says, your movie is vulgar.
And Mr. Brooks says, lady, this movie rose below vulgarity.
Yes.
Along those same lines.
But now I'm looking through and I'm seeing like the movie, the premiere was a disaster. Mm-hmm. And like you said, it was Peter Sellers pulling the ad or running the ad in Variety that made them reconsider. But it does. You know, that's what's surprising to me, because I think in general, I don't see mainstream audiences connecting with Mel Brooks. But for some reason, he's tapped into some kind of pulse or like some specific funny bone that people really, really connect to.
I mean, I gotta make the Seinfeld connection again. I mean, I think Brandon Tartikoff, who was the NBC, like a high up NBC executive, famous for his involvement in like Saturday Night Live and keeping that alive in its early seasons when it was going through some rough spots in the 80s, and involved high up at NBC when Seinfeld was starting to become a cultural like behemoth, but the show itself wasn't successful at the start, and he was one of the voices within NBC, even though like he has some street cred, being like having a good creative mind for what would sell, thinking that Seinfeld was too Jewish for, in terms of just like the sensibilities, like it is too New York centric of a show to have a mainstream appeal across the country, and then it became a big hit. And I think some of the reviews even talk about, and I think the critics are probably, I'm assuming that, I think maybe Pauline Kael gave like a withering review of it. And I don't know, maybe she's Jewish, I'm not sure. But she had said that there was some, maybe I should have done more research before saying some libelous comments. One of the critics that I read about.
This is Missing Frames. I mean, this is just, we're just about as professional as the producers in The Producers.
Like, yes.
Just as well prepared.
Come back to bed. Shut up, old woman. I'll get there when I'm done with this podcast. So I think what I was just going to say was, I think some of the reviews seemed to highlight that they thought that The Producers was a little, was very stereotypical in its presentation of some of the more, I guess, what audiences might assume were like, maybe some Jewish producer stereotypes, Jewish comedy stereotypes, and didn't rise above the comedic, I guess, this very low comedy. And for many audiences over time, that was the opposite. Fine. That's what's been appealing to people.
They thought it was great.
It's refreshing commentary. Yeah. It takes down Hitler.
Well, because it's clear-eyed. There's no filter. And it is funny. Like, it is consistently funny. And I think one of the things that surprised me was I was expecting the play to take up more time, not just the third act. Like, they find the play about halfway through the movie, and then there's like a bunch of other things that happen. Like it's them, you know, him getting all the money from the old.
They're running. They're fleeing from Liebkind.
Yeah,
well, and that's what I was going to say. Actually, I was talking about AFI's top 100. Springtime for Hitler is front and center in their preview, in so many retrospectives talking about this movie. I went into this movie thinking that was going to be the climax, and so that's what it was a surprise. Maybe it helps the movie.
I mean,
maybe
it kind
it
of is.
But
it kind
is,
of is.
It's a pleasant surprise because the movie goes beyond what you expect comedically.
Well, that I think is what threw me off, is that that is the climax. So that when they go in and they decide to blow up the theater, which is funny, that by that point, it wasn't that I was tuned out, but I felt like it was. I was like, this is in typical Mel Brooks fashion. Again, from my perception, it was like, okay, the movie's going too far past the point where I care about what's happening.
Right.
Like it's the punchline, the ultimate punchline is that the play is a hit, and then them trying to blow up the theater is funny and has the again, the longer the joke goes on, the funnier it gets at proving me wrong, which is like, then they go to the courtroom and the guy's all wrapped up in bandages, which is hysterical. But I think that's what, like, I felt kind of like, where is this going? They're blowing up the thing. We had the high of springtime for Hitler, and now we're kind of like, this is sort of funny. And then you have a great ending with them, like, you know, which Blues Brothers, I guess, kind of ripped off, but them in jail performing.
Springtime, and, Prisoners of
still,
War.
Still doing their schemes. But yeah, I thought the play, I thought it was going to be a little bit more like, let's put on a show, everybody, and a little bit more like that. But I realize now in retrospect, thinking about it, how that couldn't have worked, because the movie's not about, like, the fun of putting on a play. It's about the con. No,
we have like, Bowfinger, which kind of goes into the pun. The
yes,
fun of
or waiting for Guffman or something Guffman. Like that.
I was going to make a Bowfinger connection earlier because there's something about the Bialystock's office that reminds me of Bobby Bowfinger's house, with just the posters, even the color of the walls. Apparently Mel Brooks loves the color yellow. He thinks yellow is very funny, which is why there's so much yellow in the movie, which actually I agree. I think the tackiness of the yellow and the seediness of this kind of New York mix juxtaposed against this kind of like also almost like classic showbiz vibe really creates a unique visual look for the film that otherwise seems pretty like main like standard comedy for the time.
Right. Right.
But yeah, I guess I was just gonna say I love Bowfinger, and I know that's underrated and this movie is very popular, but I wouldn't be surprised if Steve Martin made some kind of connection between Bowfinger and
he had
movie.
To. There's no way he didn't. And I have you seen the remake?
Yes, have you?
No.
I would love to talk about that.
Yeah, go ahead and talk about
it. What's your thought or impression?
What I understand, so, you know, it went to Broadway, the show, and Matthew Broderick and Nathan Lane starred together in it. And then they were like, well, let's adapt. It's like the modern, you know, this was what, early 2000s?
This was so, like 2001, I think. 2000.
And apparently it was a big hit. Like it was, you know, it's
excellent.
It's an actual musical,
yes,
from what I understand. But it went really well. But then they did the film
not
version
good.
Of it, and not good. So, what happened there? What makes it not good? And what do you think this movie, the original producers, does that movie doesn't do?
This movie, so Broadway traditionally is like, especially now where, especially now after COVID, you know, they need these big major companies like Disney to pump money into it to fill the seats because New York is so expensive. It's so expensive to put on a show. And so there's this monopoly that a very small amount of production companies have over the big Broadway theaters. And so Broadway, generally, it's harder to find something that's a bit, original and full of like this very, I don't know, like it's very like from the ground up, we're going to put on a show in Broadway.
Yeah. Well, the producers is a little, it's off the beat. It's like Parasite winning Best Picture, where it's a little bit more like, oh, this shouldn't be here, but somehow it kind of snuck in and it slipped.
And so there's something about the producers, well, the characters themselves, they're coming up from nothing and they're like through sheer grit, determination, and like just swindling con men nature, they're gonna find success. So there's something, there's an intensity there and a heightened emotion that feels like gritty and fun and it grabs you by the balls and squeezes until you laugh. And
is that how Mel Brooks works?
That's
is
how
that
he
why
works. Yes.
I have a tough time.
yeah. And I think the musical is very Broadway in terms, it's like very clean in its product. It looks very clean. It's very, I'm talking about the stage show. It's like,
so did they, and also I imagine it's a little sterilized almost. Like
the, I would say the stage show
century.
Is not, I mean the stage show, there's, it's just, you know, I don't know. It's now they're singing and dancing where before it was like Gene Wilder screaming in a corner.
Okay.
But like the, Everything that's great about the movie is in the Broadway show. And then they modernize it a bit in terms of like they remove the LSD character and in the music. You want me to spoil some of the musical for you?
Yeah, I don't care.
All right.
I don't think I'll ever see it.
I mean, the musical itself is great. I highly recommend it. It's one of my favorite musicals out
there.
Just
don't watch the remake.
Roger Debris ends up playing Hitler. And it's hilarious. He has a solo during Springtime for Hitler as Hitler. That is hilarious. And they make the relationship between Bloom and Ula into this, like, it evolves as the show progresses into like,
It seemed like her character plays a bigger role in the remake.
And I think as a result, the ending is adjusted in a way that works really well. Springtime for Hitler also isn't the finale, but I think the climax is a bit more, it's similar, but it's adjusted enough to kind of raise the stakes a bit more and amplify the tension between the characters. It's great. The movie version of that, directed by the woman, Susan Stroman, who directed the Broadway show, I think it was one of her first movies. And there's, you know, they do something, I think if I remember correctly, there's something about like, When film production gets in the way, production values can get in the way of comedy.
Yeah.
You know, you need a static shot. Let the actors do the funny physical stuff.
And let's be real. In general, stage shows that are filmed or adapted to the screen
don't always work.
Like theater is theater. Mm-hmm. And that's an art form wholly unique that you lose something when you turn it into a film.
Right.
It's just like, unless you have somebody who is like, all right, I'm just going to make a great movie and not worry about like adapting the stage show. That's one thing. And sometimes it works, but a lot of times it doesn't, because like you're missing the audience, and theater is so dependent on like the relationship between what's on stage and the audience. And it's a unique experience that you'll never have again. So in general, a lot of the energy is lost in the translation.
Right. And it's a shame because actually the musical is great. I didn't see the original. I saw the original production, but later in its run, so I didn't get to see it with any of the stars in it. And then I saw the Curb Your Enthusiasm season that centers around the producers, which is like ties my Seinfeld connection, puts a little bow on it.
It's all connected.
It's all connected. But I would say, whereas the original movie is so full of feeling, I think it's 2005, that the 2005 musical is so devoid of it. And it's a shame because the musical is great, but I think the stunt casting kind of gets in the way. Uma Thurman is better than I would have expected, but she's not as good as an actual like singing, dancing actress. And I think Will Ferrell, I like Will Ferrell. I don't want to shit on him like some other people. I know there are some other non-Will Ferrell fans out there. I don't think he's right for the movie because he's just too much.
He's too Will
Ferrell. He brings too much baggage with him.
Right.
And Matthew Broderick is
a
little.
It's like Dustin Hoffman, if they'd cast Dustin Hoffman.
Yeah, there's just kind of like, Andrea Martin's great because she's great in everything, but she's barely in the movie. And I think everybody else is a little dead behind the eyes.
I gotcha. That's a shame.
It's a shame.
I mean, in general, like, why remake the producers at all? But I guess in terms of like, you have a hit Broadway show.
The songs are great, and the cast, the names of the cast are great.
There are dollar signs. Like, they look at it and they say, we can make some money. And maybe it did make money. I don't know. It probably made more money than the original producer.
Probably did.
In general,
if you get the chance to see the show, I say see it because the show is great and it's funny.
Okay.
But I don't think the movie.
That sounds great. But yeah, I think what's great about Mel Brooks, and I think especially in this day and age, what makes Mel Brooks special is just his unabashed ability to like go to places that, like, even back then, like just reading the critical response, oh, this is horrible, disgusting. But in general, like, that's kind of the point, and it's very, very funny. And with that in mind, do you think Producers is something like, I know we remade it in 2005, but is this something that would thrive if it had been released today? Do you think the world would be ready for it now?
It would be
like
different.
Are we getting to the point where like people are so offended by things, like, do we need another Mel Brooks to come in and kind of shake us out of that state of mind,
I think,
to get back to laughing?
If it was made a couple years ago, I don't think the Springtime for Hitler thing would have had any issues. Nowadays, there's so many people online who are like, you're a Nazi, that you know, who knows what that would have brung up. I think the Carmen Ghia and Roger Debris relationship, it gets adjusted in the musical a bit in terms of like, yes, it's still very flamboyant, but like Bialystock and Bloom are less like, in the original movie, they're very much like mugging.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And it, but it's, I mean, it's very, very funny.
Right.
It, like, I mean,
I love it.
At a certain point. Yeah. It didn't, but it was like, oh yeah, this is probably problematic, but
yes.
it's so funny because those two guys, again, so committed to the roles right. that they make it
the
very
elevator, funny. Just Zero Mostel getting out of the elevator kills me because it's so hammed up and bouncing against the walls.
Yes.
And apparently during that scene, the actor who plays Carbon Gia, who is grimacing in the elevator, apparently Zero Mostel was like grabbing something on him and squeezing.
Oh God.
Why? I don't know. He was a wacky guy, Zero.
Yeah. Well, apparently he and Mel Brooks didn't get along, so that's why he's not in other
right.
Mel Brooks movies.
And then he's,
which is sad, but yeah. you know, we got this one.
And
so
I gotta
nice.
Say, Dom DeLuise, I think, takes the Zero Must, basically does what Zero Mostel would have done in Mel Brooks's later movies. And Dom DeLuise is a freaking tour de force in all of
he's great.
Mel's stuff.
He's great.
Yeah. Oh God. There's just the name Roger Debris is funny to me.
there's a lot yeah. of stuff. I feel like I don't want to say I haven't given Mel Brooks a fair shake because I think I have, and I think I feel that I respect him more, and I love him, and I love what he did for comedy, and I love just his personality and his creativity and the gifts he's given us. Mm-hmm. I love all that and respect it more than I actually enjoy the movies. And I don't like the reason I say I feel like I've already given him a fair shake. I've seen the movies and I've watched them with the intent of like, well, maybe I wasn't open-minded, mm-hmm. but then I watched them again and I'm like, well, no, I guess it's just not my thing. I wonder if I'm just missing something. I've seen all the big ones and maybe I need to go back because it's, again, it's been a few years, but Producers in general still reflects that for me. Like, I still feel like that sense of like, I enjoyed this. I like it a lot. I see why people enjoy it. I also am still kind of shocked that it has the mainstream appeal because it feels so subtle at times. And so
it's got a legacy. So it gets away.
Yeah.
With
it didn't necessarily change my mind, but as far as like, oh my God, now I get it. But I do feel a further sense of respect for like, oh, this is like, what a wonderful legacy, and Producers is such a great debut feature and such a bold debut mm-hmm. feature. It's got this energy to it. It's got this sense of like, what, we're doing it anyway. Like the scene where LSD first appears and auditions and sings his Love Power song. Mm-hmm. It felt like it went on for 15 minutes, but it was just like, I don't know if a experienced director would have done
no.
that. And in some ways, I'm glad it's in the movie because you don't get that with an experienced director's like, we should cut out of this and get out of it.
It's not talked about as an auteur film, but it is often. But it is very much to the same as like Woody Allen's movies were.
Yeah.
And Woody Allen started zany and then got a little bit more, I guess, like quote unquote prestigious with his like more thoughtful pictures later, and he has way more
right.
of a catalog, but. Mel
right.
Brooks with the Producers and with the 12 Chairs, with his earlier movies, even the following movies, you know, Blazing Saddles, Young Frankenstein, huge cultural touchstones.
And I'll be honest, watching this made me want to go back through and just kind of like, oh, let's just start at the beginning
right.
and go through his filmography.
I think
you
should.
These.
And also, I guess we talk about the rambling, meandering nature of some of the scenes, especially earlier in the Producers, but he was a new director. He was he had been a bit more of a veteran writer, but again, his like style evolved, and he needed to get this movie out of his way to
get on to other
to be
stuff.
More polished as he went yeah. on.
And you feel that like again, the opening 22 minutes is like very like we're in a single room. There's not a whole
yeah.
lot going on to the point where when they go outside, it was like, oh my God, that's right. There's like. We were stuck in this one room for so long. It's so nice to now be in the streets of New York. I see like, again, a director finding his footing but also like being willing to have fun and try things. And I think the final result is, even if I don't love it, it's clear to me why it's, has the reputation it does,
yeah.
like why people look back on it so fondly and why people embrace it, why in retrospect it's been more embraced as people have rediscovered it and kind of watched it more and more. And I think I probably owe it to myself to watch it again at some point and to never watch the remake because that looked awful and seems to be awful.
Have you seen the Curb season? that goes into the producer?
Yes. And that's great. And that's great too. It would be fun to go back and watch that. I watched the Seinfeld episode of Curb before I saw Seinfeld, and I watched the producer's season of Curb before I saw the producers. So in general, it would be fun to go back and rewatch Curb as well. So Mel Brooks is really giving me lots of gifts here. He's given me Seinfeld. He's given me the ability to go back to Curb. Maybe I am underestimating.
You how seriously, great he is. You've watched first Seinfeld and now and then the producers through Larry David's eyes. You owe it to yourself to open your eyes
to watch it through my own eyes. Help me take this mask off, Richie, so I can watch the producers with my own eyes.
You'll cry.
But I'll cry. Yeah, well, that's probably true. What else is there to say? Are we good? Have we said everything we want about producers? Anything else you want to add as a final like punctuation mark? Because you love this movie. I enjoy it. I don't love it, but like you are the big fan. So what do you think to people who are on the fence? Like, do we think we've convinced them that they should?
I think, you know, the movie's a bit dated. You see it in some of the references and some of the jokes and in the overall pacing, but you can see like the ingredients for modern comedy are here, are in this movie, and where like comedy evolves over, I don't know. I think it's way ahead of its time in terms of like the subject matter, and when it's funny, when it drags, but when it's funny, it's some of the funniest
and
stuff.
And it's less than 90 minutes. Film. So the drags are like relatively, you're not talking about like, oh God, this is too
long. No,
like,
no, not at all. It's pretty breezy. It doesn't have like,
but I agree
pacing.
With you.
Most
yeah.
movies from that era don't. But in terms of like, you know, you hear this is the greatest comedy of all time. You think it's going to be a fast paced laugh a minute riot. And there are a lot of laughs, but sometimes you have to look a little harder than you might expect. Just analyze, listen a little closer, but the movie itself is just like it's a love letter to a more civilized age,
to the theater.
Yeah, no, that's it. That's all I have to say. Otherwise, I'll just keep.
No, it's great. Well, give me your final rating. So we'll do how many springtimes for Hitler do you give the producers on a scale of 1 to 5? With 5 being the highest.
Yeah, I would say I would give it a 4.5.
Okay, I'll give it 3.5.
Hey, that's
I think that's
kind
about right for me. But this has been great. Thank you for introducing me, for giving me the opportunity, for helping me bring Missing Frames back in style the way Mel Brooks would have wanted. Richie, if people want to find you on the internet, where can they do so?
You can find me on Twitter at Richie Pepio. That's my handle, and you can find me on Letterboxd at rpepio1.
Are you going to write a review for the producers?
A new updated review
for the producers.
I guess I might have to, although I'll probably just do what I did with my Mulholland Drive review, which is just copy and paste all of my notes that I want as I watched just,
it worked for that. It works for this too. So do it. I'm at YeShawnDoorman on Twitter, and I've been saying it wrong. I'm actually at and there's no at on Letterboxd. I'm just ShawnDoorman05. There's another ShawnDoorman.
What?
On the internet, who is cramping my style. Ugh. But you can find me there.
I hope it's
and
spelled
you can see all my ratings for all these Missing Frames, and it's great. You go read Richie's review. Thank you, Richie, again for being on here.
Thank you,
everybody, for listening. Everybody. And we will see you at the movies on Broadway.